I love the church at Greenford for the struggles you've been through in my name. I honour the men and women who have striven for my kingdom to come. But now, it is not enough. It is not enough. Judgment is here. I need clean lives, the laying down of self, lives more transparent, filled with me, more waiting on me. How can you hear me if you don't listen together? Spring clean my house, open its doors wide to my spirit, and I will fill it. Judgment is here. You can say yes or no. There is no middle way. When the Spirit of the Lord is upon you, you will preach good news to the poor, proclaim freedom for the prisoners, release for the oppressed, healing for the blind, proclaim the Lord's favour. This is what I want. Do you want it enough?
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspiring biblical teaching and other excellent Christian videos. You can order the teaching video DVDs, listen to and study the audio versions of these, or download them as audio podcasts to your computer or MP3 player. Today's inspiring and biblical teaching is called No Condemnation by Liz Robertson.
Last week we did something described as a prophetic enactment. Do you remember we had our cups and we came and we drank? And when I started to talk about that, I talked about it in the context of God's activity. That God's activity seems to be at a pace that we've not experienced before. And I came across this quote recently. I'm not sure who to attribute it to, so I won't say anything. But I liked it because it kind of, for me, set a tone to where we're at the moment. It says this: we are living in a season of divine acceleration. There is a quickening spirit abroad in the earth as the Father seeks to upgrade us in our spiritual development. We must move away from merely knowing about God towards an ongoing experience of his nature and glory. I'll say that again. We're living in a season of divine acceleration. There is a quickening spirit abroad in the earth as the Father seeks to upgrade us in our spiritual development. We must move away from merely knowing about God towards an ongoing experience of his nature and glory. If we are not confident of God's nature towards us, we will not progress. God wants to move. He is on the move. Is he going to leave his church behind? He doesn't want to. But if we're not confident of God's nature towards us, we will miss what it is he wants to do. I think in what God is wanting to do in and through his church, it includes an anointing of blessing. But with that anointing of blessing, there is a fresh call to new depths of holiness. I'll say that again. God is talking to his church. God is moving us on, wanting to have a deeper relationship with him, corporately and individually. He is looking to move in this country. And the places where he's going to move are where places where people's hearts are open to him and want to see him move. And I would say this is one of these places. And with that comes a fresh call to new depths of holiness. You cannot encounter God and want to move on with him and remain unchanged. It is not possible. We must allow him to touch us, to meet with us, yes, to challenge us, so that we can move with him in these times. If we determine that we are not going to change, if we are determined to pick and choose what we will and will not do, he cannot move. It will not happen. I want us to look briefly at three times in Scripture where God meets with man. Let's turn, first of all, to Isaiah chapter 6. Now, I don't have one of your Bibles. Someone finds Isaiah chapter 6. If you can call out the page to help other people, that would be great.
690.
Now, if someone's got a Bible like this, you can help me, because I can't find it. Now, here we are. Okay, so this is a slightly different version to what most of you, if you've got church Bibles, will be reading. Starting at verse 1. It was in the year of King Uzziah's death that I saw the Lord. He was sitting on a lofty throne. Just picture this. Imagine yourself for a moment that you are Isaiah. He was sitting on a lofty throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Attending him were mighty seraphim, each having six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, with two they flew. They were calling out to each other, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of heaven's armies. The whole earth is filled with his glory." Their voices shook the temple to its foundations, and the entire building was filled with smoke. Then I said, "It is all over. I am doomed. For I am a sinful man. I have filthy lips, and I live among a people with filthy lips. Yet I have seen the King, the Lord of heaven's armies." I guess we can relate to Isaiah's feelings and the way he expresses himself here. To be in the presence of the living God, must be an awesome, awesome thing. And what happens when you come up against that perfect holiness? You become starkly aware of your sinfulness, of how big the gulf is between us and him. How wretched we are. And for Isaiah, you can just imagine him throwing his arms up and saying, "That's it, it's all over, I can't do this, it's just, no, look at this, look at me." But he's confessing here, isn't he? He's actually confessing his sin, his sinfulness. He's actually, in the presence of God, he can do nothing else but say, "Yes, I am undone." Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a burning coal he had taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. He touched my lips with it and said, "See, this coal has touched your lips. Now your guilt is removed and your sins are forgiven. You are cleansed. You are cleansed. Your sins are forgiven." Then I heard the Lord asking, "Whom shall I send as a messenger to this people? Who will go for us?" I said, "Here I am, send me." Let's look at Jesus encountering the woman at the well. Luke 4. Again, if you find it, call out the number of the page. Oh no, it's not Luke 4, sorry. It's John 4. John 4. Thank you. I'm going to read this in kind of batches, so I'm going to skip some verses, just so we get a taste of what this encounter was like. So there's Jesus waiting at the well by himself at a long walk. He was weary. It was about midday. Soon, verse 7, a Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Please give me a drink." He was alone at the time because his disciples had gone into the village to buy some food. The woman was surprised, for Jews refused to have anything to do with Samaritans. She said to Jesus, "You're a Jew. I'm a Samaritan woman. Why are you asking me for a drink?" Jesus replied, "If only you knew the gift God had for you and who you're speaking to, you would ask me, and I would give you living water." She then queried, "How are you going to get the water? You haven't got a bucket, you haven't got a rope." Jesus replied, "Anyone who drinks this water will soon become thirsty again. But those who drink the water I give will never be thirsty again. It becomes a fresh, bubbling spring within them, giving them eternal life." "Please, sir," the woman said, "give me this water that I will never be thirsty again. I won't have to come here to get water." "Go and get your husband," Jesus told her. "I don't have a husband," the woman replied. Jesus said, "You're right. You don't have a husband. For you've had 5 husbands and you aren't even married to the man that you're living with now. You certainly spoke the truth." "Sir," the woman said, "you must be a prophet." And then carrying on further down the page in verse 25, the woman said, "I know the Messiah is coming, the one who is called Christ. When he comes, he will explain everything to us." And Jesus told her, "I am the Messiah." Of course, further on in the story, she then leaves, verse 28, left her water jar behind and ran back to her village to tell everybody, "Come and see a man who told me everything." And further on in the story, verse 39, many Samaritans from the village believed in Jesus because the woman had said, "He told me everything I ever did." Another encounter. On both of those occasions, people were, if you like, exposed and challenged. But at no time were they condemned or made to feel worthless or that it was irredeemable. That is the nature of God. I think sometimes we can have a very warped impression of the God that we serve. On the one hand, we know he saves us from our sins, but when it comes to our condition now, as we walk with him, we feel unworthy, inadequate, sinful, and we hide from him. I want us to look at another challenge, the way God spoke to churches. The letters in Revelation, the last book of the Bible. Looking at Revelation chapter 2, the first letter, the message to the church at Ephesus. God says, "I know all the things you do. I have seen your hard work and your patient endurance. I know that you don't tolerate evil people. You have examined the claims of those who say they are apostles but are not. You have discovered them as liars. You have patiently suffered for me without quitting. But I have this complaint against you. You do not love me or each other as you first did. Look how far you have fallen. Turn back to me and do the works you did at first. If you do not repent, I will come and remove your lampstand from the place among the churches. But this is in your favour. You hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, just as I do. Anyone with ears to hear must listen to the Spirit and understand what he is saying to the churches. To everyone who is victorious, I will give the fruit from the tree of life in the paradise of God. And over the page, in chapter 3, the message to the church at Laodicea. Again, he says, I know all the things you do, that you are neither hot nor cold. I wish that you were one or the other, but since you are like lukewarm water, neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. You say, I am rich, I have everything I want, I don't need a thing. And you don't realize that you are wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. So I advise you to buy gold from me, gold that has been purified by fire. Then you will be rich. Also, buy your white garment from me, so you will not be shamed by your nakedness, and ointment for your eyes, so you will be able to see. I correct and discipline everyone I love. So be diligent and learn from your indifference. Look, I stand at the door and knock. If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and we will share a meal together as friends. Those who are victorious will sit with me on my throne just as I was victorious and sat with my Father on his throne. Two letters of exhortation. Two letters where God says, these things are good. But these things aren't, and I challenge you on these things to make you better. Not, I challenge you on these things to make you feel wretched, to make you realise that you're useless. It's not that. He's not saying that. He's saying, I want you to be better. I have gifts for you. Come, let me tend to those things that need changing, need to be removed. And we can do this together. There is no condemnation mentioned in anything that we've looked at this morning. Quite the contrary. With Isaiah, there was cleansing. There was a shift in how he saw himself. The Christian message is forgiveness, isn't it? Can we forgive ourselves? Sometimes that's the biggest hurdle to moving on with God. Allowing God to forgive us. And what happened to Isaiah? Immediately after he knew that he was forgiven, that his sins were no more. Did he sit back? No. He was filled with a desire to serve. Here I am, he said, send me. There was that impetus then to do what God wanted doing. So not only did he get cleansed, but there was a moving on in Isaiah, a change in where he wanted to be, a desire to serve God. And of course, the whole book of Isaiah, wonderful scripture. Our motto comes from it this year. Look at the woman. She wasn't condemned. In fact, she marvelled at the way that God spoke into her life and was able to say, you're right, I know all about you. She ran away, yes, but she ran away to bring other people back. God pinpointed something in her life that needed changing, and she didn't run away to hide. There was something in the way that Jesus engaged with her that made her want to know more, and not only want to know more, but to have other people know more too. Do you see how when we open ourselves up to God and allow him to move in our lives, other things follow and happen and affect other people? It's not just about us. It impacts on all around us, potentially. So there is that challenge in Revelation to come back to your first love. Maybe for some of us this morning, we've lost our way a little bit. God isn't saying, no, I don't want to know you now. You haven't blown it. He wants you to return and come to him again afresh. What is God wanting to say to you this morning? If you are here this morning and you want to hear from God, I can assure you he will be speaking to you. Not one of us will leave this building without having something from God, because that is the nature of our God. And it will not be condemning. It will be freeing. It will be cleansing. It will be moving on. It will be releasing. It will be seeing more of his kingdom in our lives. It's about forgiveness. Do you remember the song? I'm not going to sing it. You'd be pleased to know. It talks about the new wine of the kingdom. I just heard it in my head the other day. Come on in and taste the new wine, the wine of the kingdom, the wine of the kingdom of God. Here is healing and forgiveness. Somehow you can't separate the two. To receive healing, to receive forgiveness, is to receive healing. We had a letter from God, rather like the letters in Revelation. It's 10 years old now. Listen how the pattern follows, the pattern of the letters to the churches that we've read. I love the church at Greenford for the struggles you've been through in my name. I honour the men and women who have striven for my kingdom to come. But now, it is not enough. It is not enough. Judgment is here. I need clean lives. The laying down of self, lives more transparent, filled with me, more waiting on me. How can you hear me if you don't listen together? Spring clean my house, open its doors wide to my spirit, and I will fill it. Judgment is here. You can say yes or no. There is no middle way. When the Spirit of the Lord is upon you, you will preach good news to the poor, proclaim freedom for the prisoners, release for the oppressed, healing for the blind, proclaim the Lord's favour. This is what I want. Do you want it enough? And there, that whole chunk there about when the Spirit of the Lord is upon you, that's what Jesus read from the scroll in Luke 4. Luke 4? Yeah, Luke 4. And he was, of course, quoting Isaiah. We've come full circle back to Isaiah, the words of Isaiah. And as I said last week, a lot of the time, well, most of the time, when we read these lines, preach good news to the poor, proclaim freedom for the prisoners, release for the oppressed, we see those applying to people who don't yet know God. But what I would like us to do again today is look at those lines for us. You turn to Luke 4. Luke 4, verse 18. Proclaim that captives will be released. If we don't know God's forgiveness, we can be held captive. If we still beat ourselves over the head about things in our past, that's a prison. If we have a false sense or understanding of God's nature towards us, we're in bondage. The time of the Lord's favour has come. He wants to bless us. He wants to be in relationship with us, whatever our condition. No condemnation. Read those lines to yourselves for a few moments. Last week, people were invited to come and drink water from the well. Just as Jesus said to the woman at the well that he could source living water in her, we believe that we have a well here. At the moment, it's a pot with water in it, but there is a well here of God's blessing and resource, not just for us, but for the community. But today, I want to invite us. There are cups at the back of the hall there on the table. And if you want to respond to God today, in a little while there will be opportunity to come and drink from that well again. Whatever you want to say to God today, it does not matter, but the opportunity is here to respond to what he may have been saying to you today. That letter in Revelation is to a church, and he says, I stand at the door and knock. It's up to us to open that door. It may not be the easiest thing to do, but it would be the right thing to do this morning. God gave me an illustration, I think he did. While I'm in my busyness of rushing to do three things at once and thinking about the next three things at the same time, you know that? I was unloading the washing machine. Who wears socks here? Be honest, when you take them off and they kind of like ball up and scrunch up, you just chuck them in the laundry basket, or do you kind of undo them nicely? My husband does not undo his nicely. I don't either. They just get balled up and chucked in the laundry basket. And do I, in my rush, go through every sock and undo it and throw it in the washing machine? No, I should, but I don't. And as I was unloading the washing machine the other night, I saw this balled up sock come out. And I thought, oh, it was a waste of time, wasn't it? It's been washed kind of where it's been exposed, but a lot of it is all inside. And maybe it got a bit wet, but how much detergent got in it, I don't know. Do you know, we can be like a balled up sock. I'll give you that much. But don't look at this part. I'll keep this part here because it's too yick and horrible, and sometimes I enjoy it, so I'm going to keep it to myself. How clean is a balled up sock? Not as clean as it could be. How clean are we when we hold things back from God? Yes, we go in the washing machine, church, or whatever. But unless we are completely open and upfront and honest with God, we ain't going to be washed properly. That's what we need to do. We've got a whole weekend of being in a washing machine next weekend in summer soak. Let's take a moment in our busyness before it starts to say, yes, I'm going to undo my balled up sock. I'm going to be completely open to what God wants to do in and through me. Because he is not a God of condemnation, people. He is a God of blessing and abundance. We may feel like Isaiah, I am a sinful man. You may not even know Jesus this morning, I don't know. But you may be curious, like that woman at the well. Come and drink. Come and receive. Say, yes, I'm allowing you in that area that you haven't touched. Come and do it this morning. I'm just going to read Psalm 32, and then we're going to have some music playing, and you can do as you feel you want to respond to Jesus. Oh, what joy for those whose disobedience is forgiven, whose sin is put out of sight. Yes, what joy for those whose record with the Lord has been cleared of guilt. For those whose lives are lived in complete honesty. When I refused to confess my sin, my body wasted away, and I groaned all day long. Day and night, your hand of discipline was heavy on me. My strength evaporated like water in the summer heat. Finally, I confessed all my sin to you and stopped trying to hide my guilt. I said to myself, I will confess my rebellion to the Lord. And you forgave me. All my guilt is gone. Therefore, all the godly people pray to you while there is still time, that they may not drown in the flood water of judgment. For you are my hiding place. You protect me from trouble. You surround me with songs of victory. The Lord says, I will guide you along the best pathway for your life. I will advise you and watch over you. Do not be like a senseless horse or mule that needs a bit and a bridle to keep it under control. Many sorrows come to the wicked, but unfailing love surrounds those who trust the Lord. So rejoice in the Lord and be glad, all you who obey him. Shout for joy, all you whose hearts are pure.
Father God, as we respond to your word this morning, I pray that you would see our hearts and that you would meet us where we're at and bring your cleansing, bring your infilling. Touch us and cleanse us where we need to have your hand, to have your spirit move. Father, we pray towards next weekend that it is going to be a time of encountering you in ways that we have never encountered you before. And Father, as we prepare ourselves for that, would you remind us of the message you've said to us today all through these days of this coming week? We'd continue to drink from you, and that we would know that well of living water bubbling up within each one of us, affecting the lives of the people that we encounter, that we spend our time with during this week, that we would be your source to those people, Father God. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Thank you.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our postcode is UB69UA. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.